Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Holy Communion of Creation Tide. You know that we've had a different card this few weeks, and it's the season of creation that the Church of England has put into its festivals throughout the year. And this is one of the services today that they have put forward as the Eucharist for the environment and for creation time, and called it Creation Tide. Some of you may have the sheets. We weren't too sure if the streaming system and the screens are going to work this morning, as we've had a little problem in the last couple of weeks. So we printed out sheets as well. Those of you can see from the screen. If you can't see, there are some sheets like this with the service on. We have some notices before we start. Next week is the final service in our Creation Tide, or our environmental time, and it's the 3rd of October Harvest Festival. So just a reminder, please bring tinned and dried fruit for the food bank, please, which we are now starting to support again as a church. I know those of you have been supporting it throughout COVID, but at St. Catherine's. So please bring those things for next week's service. Also, it was great to see that there was tea and coffee last week. Lots of people stayed, but unfortunately there isn't any this week because nobody signed up the sheet to do it. So we're going to go on as we mean to go on. If we want tea and coffee, both services, we need somebody to sign up to do it. I know it seems perhaps an onerous task, but you only need to do it perhaps once every 6 weeks or once a month. It's not huge numbers of people, but everybody does appreciate it when it happens. So please think about that. Also, a reminder, can everybody, when you come to the church, please use the vicarage car park outside the house? It's a way to stop people from coming in, and it's also a way to stop people from coming along and stealing all the stonework and stuff, which is what happened evidently when Sally and Rupert first moved in. Because it was empty, people came along and did all sorts of stuff. So if they think there's still people around, that would really help to keep everything safe. During communion, there will be songs or a hymn for this service and the second service to enable us to reflect on the sermon or to pray silently. And we would invite you to do that as part of our worship this morning. John has a notice now. Can you move over, John? Sorry, people can't hear you, Muddy. Thank you. come to the podium if you wish.
No, I thought my school teacher boys would carry some back. Last week had a special service to celebrate International Choir Day. Some of you were here. If you were here, you were set a challenge. The answers to the challenge are on the table at the back. If you weren't here and you want to do the challenge, there are service sheets from last week taken away. Don't take the answers as well.
Thank you, John. And thank you. We say thank you to John and the choir for everything last week. It was really good. Yes, give them the clap. Well done. Although I think there was something going on, because on Thursday they said, there's only two people coming, so please come and sing, Viv. So I turned up and there was the biggest choir we've ever seen. So I think the telephones have been really busy that week. But it was great. Thank you. We draw to our service now. So if you have a sheet or if you're looking at the screen, we gather in praise of the God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord be with you and also with you. We're going to stand for our first hymn this morning, All Things Bright and Beautiful, but we do omit verse 4. So let's stand to sing 5:3:3.
Thank you.
Please be seated. We come to our time now in preparation for saying that we're sorry for those things that we've done and those things that we haven't done. We say together our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our greed and repent of the ways in which we have damaged God's good creation. We confess to you our lack of care for the world you have given us. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We confess to you our selfishness in not sharing the earth's bounty fairly. Christ, have mercy. We confess to you our failure to protect the environment. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
We say together our Gloria. Oh. We sing together our Gloria, which is great.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit. In the glory of God the Father. Amen.
We have our collect, a special one for today. In a time of silence, let us pray that our worship will bring us closer to the one who has created all things. Glorious God, the whole creation proclaims your marvelous work. Increase in us a capacity to wonder and delight in it, that heaven's praise may echo in our hearts and our lives, be spent as good stewards of the earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're now going to have our next hymn, which is hymn number 439. Could you move one on, Mark? Thank you. Let's stand to sing.
Thank you.
Alleluia, Alleluia. You're worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things. Alleluia. Alleluia. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 to 34. Glory to you, O Lord. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not so much more valuable than they? Can any one of you be worrying a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If this is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Please be seated.
May the spoken words be faithful to the written word and lead us closer to the living word, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. The beautiful piece of scripture from the Sermon on the Mount, which is our gospel reading this morning, seems to point to two messages to those of us who live in worrying times. The first, in fact, is don't spend all your time worrying about what tomorrow might bring. Today has worries enough of its own, but worrying about them won't do any good. Yes, well, it's true enough that worrying can have negative effects on our life. Worry can damage our health, worry can damage our relationships, worry can rob our joy, worry can rob our opportunities. Our worry can affect ourselves, our worry can affect others, our worry can affect our relationship with God. Worry can have all these negative effects, but we might well respond to this by saying, that's all very well, but if I'm not concerned about the problems which I face, I'll go under and I won't get important stuff done. Yes, and that might well be true. Certainly, there is a genuine place for concern in responsible living. But concern and worry are not the same thing. Concern acknowledges that something needs careful thought. Worry is given to consuming trepidation. Concern gives way to planning. Worry gives way to fear. Concern leads to healthy attention. Worry leads to unhealthy anxiety. Concern moves you to action. Worry immobilizes you. Planning for tomorrow is time well spent. Worrying about tomorrow is time wasted. So, given that there is much to concern us in our lives at the present time, the first message from our passage today is be concerned, but don't be immobilized by worry. Our gospel passage doesn't promise us a trouble-free life, but it does offer us a worry-free life, because it takes for granted that God gives all the grace and mercy we need to tackle our problems, grace in abundance. And the passage develops its argument by pointing to how God treats the birds of the air and the lilies in the field. The birds are always fed, the lilies look beautiful. So surely God will treat us just as well. So don't worry about food and clothing. Well, yes, but let's just look at a moment at those birds. For perhaps they're not doing quite so well as our passage suggests. In Britain alone, 7 species of breeding birds have been lost in the last century, and 37 species face being wiped out in the future. To name a few, we might be saying goodbye to puffins, curlews, kingfishers, herring gulls, and lapwings. And of course, the reason behind all this are farming methods and climate change. There was a cartoon in a Punch magazine early last century which showed a vicar talking to a farmer whilst they both gazed at a field of lush grass. "It's wonderful what God can do with a little help," said the vicar. "Maybe," comes the reply, "but you should have seen it when he had it to himself." Well, I'm fortunate to live on a local farm and to enjoy the beauty of the landscape with its managed fields and animals. And I'm well aware of all the thought and planning and hard work which goes into such a farm in order to keep it afloat, particularly in these post-Brexit days. And one consequence of modern farming's attempt to produce food at reasonable prices is weed control, with a consequent reduction in insect life and less redundant seed to feed those birds of the air. They might have been all right when God had it all to himself, but the substantial help that we've been giving God in shaping the landscape has had all sorts of unintended consequences, not least on the birds of the air. We're right to be concerned. And what are other creatures? Around the globe, hundreds of species are at risk of extinction. Polar bears might cease to exist in the Arctic if the ice sheet continues to shrink. There are only 40 annual tigers left in the world. The number of elephants has fallen by 70% in recent decades. Even the humble kangaroo is at risk with temperature rise and hotter dry seasons. And all this, of course, is a consequence of human activity and its effect on global warming and climate change. There's an old saying, God produces enough to meet our need, but not to meet our greed. And one of the primary ways God meets our need is through each other. And he uses us to meet others' needs as well as our own. Food banks, energy and land conservation are all ways in which God's grace can work through us. And at last, politicians are taking this seriously, as the coming climate conference suggests. A week or two ago, for a few days in our cathedral, there was a Gaia exhibition with a gigantic earthscape, the view of Earth from the moon, dominating it all. That view, when we first saw it in the 60s, changed our perception of our planet. We saw a tiny dot of colour floating through the darkness of space. We realised both how beautiful and how vulnerable our planet is. And since then, scientists have been tackling with some vigour the question, why is there life on Earth and will it continue? The physicist, Professor Paul Davies, has called it the Goldilocks question. Why does the universe seem to be on our side? And why is the Earth just right for life? Like Goldilocks, not too hot, not too cold, but just right. This is quite a miracle, the professor explains. For were the laws of physics and the values of fundamental qualities to be only minutely different from what they are, then existence as we know it would be impossible, and certainly there would be no life. He examines several possible answers. Perhaps it's just a fluke that the physical laws and properties are thankfully just as they are, and just as they are just right for life. Or perhaps, he speculates, perhaps in fact we inhabit just one of a multitude of universes, all with different physical laws and properties, and this happens to be the one that is life-friendly. Or perhaps, he says, there is only one universe, but it somehow engineers its own self-awareness. The physical laws which enable minds to evolve, are they themselves fine-tuned by those same self-reflecting minds? So together, laws and minds become just right for one another. Or perhaps, he controversially suggests, perhaps religious faith is right after all. The universe knew that we were coming and is just right for life and life as we know it, capable of giving and receiving love, because it was willed into being by the mind of a loving God. In the beginning was the mind of God. It is that loving mind which we encounter when we come to Eucharist. It is to that loving God who created us, redeemed us, restored us to new life through the life and death and the reforming grace of his Son that we now come in Eucharist to encounter his grace in abundance. As the hymn has it, there's a wideness in God's mercy like the wideness of the sea. And that reminded me of the fact that when the first Spanish sailors discovered the Amazon River, they'd been sailing for weeks across the hostile Atlantic Ocean. Their water was almost gone, and they were rationing it carefully, a drop at a time. The mouth of the river was so wide that they couldn't see the banks. They thought that they were still far out on sea. Yet all the time, they were sailing on a boundless river of fresh water. They were rationing their stale water a drop at a time. Yet all they had to do was to dip their hands over the side and drink in the fresh new life all around in abundance. Our world can be like that. Battered, lonely, wounded folk, eking out their drops of friendship and love, when all around is a sea of God's love and grace, and all we have to do is to turn to Jesus and scoop up his love in bucketfuls. There's a wideness in God's mercy like the wideness of the sea. And to that God of abundant grace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honour and glory, worship and power, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Bishop Tom. That was wonderful. We're going to stand now for our response hymn, which is 519. Sometimes a light surprises the Christian while he sings. It is the Lord who rises with healing in his wings. Please stand.
Thank you.
please take your cards or your sheets and all look on the screen as we say together our affirmation of faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated as we have our intercessions.
God of life, as we enter prayer now, we pause to be still and recenter our scattered senses upon the presence of God. Jesus, we fix our eyes on you, the author and perfecter of our story. We choose to rejoice in God's supreme authority today and join with the ancient praise of all God's people. After each short section, I will say, we bring our thanks, good Lord. Your response will be, your mercy endures forever. We bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. The earth is the Lord's and all that is upon it. Let us give thanks to God, the God of all peoples of the earth, for the colour and forms of your creation and our place in it. We bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. For our daily food and those whose work and skill bring food and good gifts to us. We bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. For the gifts and graces inspired in human minds and hearts, for insight and imagination, for the skills of research that bring healing and fulfillment to the lives of many. We bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. For the light and shades of the changing season and their variety, for new life and growth out of barrenness and decay. We give our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. For new hope and strength in our communities, especially in your church and among all you call to serve you. We bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. For all those in whose lives we see goodness, kindness, gentleness, patience, humility, and all the fruits of the Spirit, we bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. For the life we have been given, and all those whom you have given us to share it. We give our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. Father God, in whose love we live and move, we pray for a world crying out to feel loved, wanted, cherished, and unique. We pray for a world torn apart by conflict and war, a world that lives uneasily in a climate of fear with no vision for future days. We pray for a world that thinks less of others than self, a world where division between nations, race, religion, neighbour, and family leads to distrust. We pray for a world that is short on happiness, too busy to enjoy all that you have created, too preoccupied with living to appreciate life. We pray for a world that needs to know your love, your hope, your peace, your joy, your salvation. A world that needs to know it is special and is uniquely loved by a Heavenly Father. We bring our thanks, good Lord. Your mercy endures forever. Creator God, forgive our moments of ingratitude, the spiritual blindness that prevents us from appreciating the wonders of this world, the endless cycles of nature, of life, death, and rebirth. Forgive us for taking without giving, reaping without sowing. Open our eyes to see, our lips to praise, and our hands to share. May our feet tread lightly on the path we tread, and our footsteps be worthy of following, for they lead to you. Lord, we yield ourselves to your mighty hand today. Father, help us live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help us to give ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. Spirit, help us love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all we do and say. Amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
You shall go out in joy and led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you will sing with song, and all the trees of the fields will clap their hands. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Shall we just stand and sort of wave at people and acknowledge that they're here this morning? That's amazing. That's the quietest piece of it. That's wonderful. Thank you. Okay. We're coming to our hymn now. 768. Put thou thy trust in God. We're already standing, so we sing 768.
Thank you.
as the grain once scattered in the fields and the grapes once dispersed on the hillside are now united on this table in bread and wine, so, Lord, may your whole church soon be gathered together from the corners of the earth into your kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. And now we give you thanks, because all things are of your making, all times and seasons obey your laws. But you have chosen to create us in your own image, setting us over the whole world in all its wonder. You have made us stewards of your creation, to praise you day by day for the marvels of your wisdom and power, so earth unites with heaven to sing a new song of creation. Holy, holy Lord, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. We sit or kneel in prayer. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Draw near with faith. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Thank you.
Prayer after communion. Creator God, send your Holy Spirit to renew this living world, that the whole creation, in its groaning and striving, may know your loving purpose and come to reflect your glory, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We come to our final hymn, which is number 794, The King of Love, the Shepherd Is. Then we'll have a few more prayers, and then we're going to go out the back door again, if that's okay with everybody. Please leave your sheets on the pews so that we can pick them up ready. Thank you.
Please remain standing while all creatures stand in expectation what will be the result of our liberty. As the whole of creation looks with eager longing for the redemption of humankind, let us pledge ourselves anew to serve our Creator God, the Father who is the maker of all things, the Son through whom all things are made, and the Holy Spirit, the giver of life, who renews the face of the earth. Let us affirm our commitment to care actively for God's creation. Lord of life and giver of hope, we pledge ourselves to care for creation, to reduce our waste, to live sustainably, and to value the rich diversity of life. May your wisdom guide us, that life in all its forms may flourish, and may be faithful in voicing creation's praise. Creator God, send your Holy Spirit to renew this living world, that the whole creation, in its groaning and striving, may know your loving purpose and come to reflect your glory, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace, and may the commitment we have made this day be matched by our faithful living. Thanks be to God.